Well, this is an exciting day. After working with Jim Binnicker for about the last year and a half, we're finally ready to break ground on Village 5. It's going to be 96 new apartments in four buildings, and I don't think they've done an apartment building here in many years, so we're looking forward to it.
This is the construction for Building 5. We're doing the groundbreaking today. It's the excitement of knowing that in a year, year and a half, that the Bob Hope and the Teresa Village will now be one, and we can all get together and just be one group of people that are all just together, and we love being doing things, we love the excitement, and it'll be more of a combination of just enjoyment, a peace of mind, security of knowing we're here, and that's what we're looking so forward to.
It's an exciting thing, and it's beautiful. It really is. I'm wondering if it'll actually look that gorgeous when we finish.
We're looking forward to the groundbreaking for Village 5. Some of us have been in Village, Teresa Village, for a long time. I've been there 10 years. My husband's been there 10 years.
I just want to say it's a blessing to be here. And my mother and I came to the house, Hawthorne House, and now this, and I hope I'll be a permanent resident over here then.
Oh, it'll be such an upgrade for us. You know, we've been in the same place of that. Our buildings were built back in, I think, probably very, very early 70s.
Well, I'm Don Gaetz. I'm president of the Florida Senate, and I'm here today because as a resident of Okaloosa County, as somebody who has spent over 20 years here, I'm so impressed with the work that the Air Force Enlisted Village has done to be a magnet for people all over this country to come here, to know that they have a place here, a home here, and now we've got a $17 million project that's being undertaken without a single penny of state, federal, or local government money. This is being done because of good management and good stewardship and great philanthropy in this area. I'm just here to celebrate it on behalf of the people of Florida.
A new living space. Two bedrooms, bath and a half, washer, dryer.
Yes. Yeah.
That was the demand.
That's it. Yeah.
It's exciting. Just the thought of it is exciting.
Well, good morning, friends, neighbors, and residents, and welcome to the Air Force Enlisted Village. We're pleased to have you here, and we thank you for sharing in this very special event. I'm Brooke McLean, the Air Force Enlisted Village Director of Development. Our groundbreaking ceremony today represents the beginning of a new chapter in the remarkable story of the Air Force Enlisted Village. For nearly five decades, this organization has assisted a group of very amazing individuals who have served and continue to serve our nation. The spouses and families of our military service members deserve our highest recognition and our utmost respect. And when required, they deserve our support and commitment to make sure that they always know the Air Force family will care for them. Today, we demonstrate that commitment and turn the page to the next chapter of our Air Force Enlisted Village. Before we start, let me introduce some of our distinguished guests. And the list is quite long, so in the interest of time, I'm going to ask that we hold the applause until the end of the announcements. First off, I'd like to recognize our very special guest, the President of the Florida Senate, Senator Don Gaetz. Yeah, no applause, no applause. I know, I almost applauded myself. Our Chairman of the Board, Mr. Nick Nicholson, and his wife, Josephine. General and Mrs. Woolley, General and Mrs. Chedister, General Reamer, General Comer, Mrs. Valene Harris, the spouse of General Harris, 96th Test Wing Commander, Mrs. Christine Canterbury, the spouse of Colonel Todd Canterbury, the 33rd Fighter Wing Commander, a member of our Chief of Staff Civic Leader Group, the Air Force's Chief of Staff Civic Leader Group, Mr. Tony Hughes, the AFSOC Command Chief, Chief Bill Turner, Mrs. Mayumi Snoddy, the spouse of Chief Mess Sergeant Marcus Snoddy, 96th Test Wing Command Chief, Chief Scott Berge and his wife Jerry, the Matthews NCO Academy Commandant, Chief Rob Nolan. Also in attendance, Mrs. Helen Hunt Rigdon from Congressman Miller's office, Miss Jean Dutton, District Commissioner Mr. Wayne Harris, District Commissioner Mr. Dave Parasote, District Commissioner Mr. Don Amons, former President and CEO of the Air Force Enlisted Village, Mr. Loyal Weaver, and some of our remarkable board members who dedicate so much time and talent to us, Mr. Kim Wintner, Mr. Mark Wilkie, Mr. Tom Westemeyer, Mr. Tony Barnes. And finally, of course, we do not want to skip out on, and I see Mr. Gary Plum. I'm sorry, sir, I almost missed you. We also want to recognize our remarkable chairman and CEO, Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, number 9, Jim Binnicker. Thank you very much. And thank everyone else who is attending today. We appreciate it. Your attendance just emphasizes how important the work is that we have before us. So now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our Chairman of the Board, Mr. Nick Nicholson.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to be here. And what a wonderful, wonderful day in paradise. First of all, thank you all for coming and attending this wonderful event. It is indeed my honor and pleasure to serve as the chairman of this outstanding board. I cannot begin to tell you the amount of expertise and professionalism that this group of men and women have brought to the board. Their vision and willingness to move forward to ensure the safety and the future of the residents was necessary to bring us to where we are today. I personally would also thank Lieutenant General Woolley, who chaired the Long Range Planning Committee, and his committee for doing an outstanding job. It is also very important that I thank Chief Binnicker on behalf of the board for his foresight and leadership abilities that have brought us to this very important day. He is fortunate to have a very supportive staff to accomplish all that he has. And the board and I would like to offer our sincere thanks to the staff for a job well done. And having been associated with Chief Binnicker for the last several years, it's easy to see that his leadership is a great asset to our foundation and that he can handle any task with the greatest of ease. And this became more evident during the negotiations on the sale of Teresa Village. His primary concern during all that negotiation was protecting the residents of Teresa Village. He was very, very adamant that during the construction of Village 5, that those residents would see little change in their living arrangements. So having said that, I would like to thank the residents for their patience and tolerance during the turmoil of this intense period of time. And believe me, happier days are just around the corner. As we all know, St. Patrick's Day is Monday. And there's a little bit of Irish in all of us. And the Irish have a saying for everything. And one comes to mind is, may your troubles be less and your blessings be more, and that nothing but happiness comes through your door. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate your comments. We'd now like to invite Mr. Loyal Weaver to the podium to speak. As mentioned before, he was the former president and CEO of the Air Force Enlisted Village. Sir, thank you very much.
Thank you, Brooke. Takes me a while to get up here. I'm getting old for fits. The other day, my wife said, let's go upstairs and fool around. And I said, honey, make up your mind. I can't do both. Distinguished guests, distinguished visitors all, that it's getting hit by the flag. Now this is patriotic. This is a beautiful day, and this is a beautiful campus. Helen and I are so pleased to be back on this beautiful Pueblo Village campus, which we dearly love. We've spent many years here. I'll tell you later how we started with this mess. But I was told by Brooke, who's our director of marketing for the foundation, Scarlett Bauman, that I was to give the complete history of Pueblo Village. But do it in 5 minutes or I'm going to kill you. Now, because of that, I'm going to have to be very quick. If any of you really have the time, like a few hours of free time and a good bottle of scotch, I'll really get into some history. But today, I think you're just going to get a bullet summary of what's happened with Pueblo Village. And I'm going to stick to a script because I've been known to be a mic hog, and she would kill me. The historical summary, really 50 years ago, back in 67, Air Force Sergeant Association chapter in the Pentagon area, D.C., was asked to see about forming up something to do for our enlisted widows, and they went and organized a charter and got the foundation chartered in January 68, which was the Air Force Enlisted Men's Widows and Dependents Home Foundation, Inc. Now try putting that on your letterheads, and then you're... But that was the original charter in D.C., and we maintained the D.C. office until 92 when we built our headquarters over here. That's how it all started back in 68, actually, with the original charter. In 72, the Air Force signed a memorandum of understanding to give us moral support, and they did an awful lot of support. In 73, Representative Bob Sykes, one of our good congressmen who we had over there, introduced a bill to authorize the Secretary of Air Force to transfer 79 acres from Eglin to Pueblo Village. In 74, we received our first Air Force Assistance Fund monies, and this was critical to getting this place started. Bob Hope Village needed that money, or it couldn't even hope to begin. Air Force Village for the officers needed the money, and therefore it was a combined effort to get that fund started and bring in some donations to get both of our charters thriving. In 75, Bob Sykes reintroduced his bill, which he had put forth in 73. Congress worked in about like it works now. He reintroduced his bill, and we then went and bought Teresa Village. In 76, the planning for the new retirement center, which was to be later Pueblo Village, started. In 77, we had our first Bob Hope show on Eglin in the King Hangar. In 78, President Carter signed Sykes' bill finally for our 79-acre transfer, and we bought it from the Air Force. In 79, Bob Hope signed an agreement allowing us to use his name and logo, which was significant. We're the only ones he's ever given his name and logo to. In 1980, we purchased this 79 acres from the Air Force. In 81, we had our first groundbreaking. Today is I think this is the eighth groundbreaking on this campus. In 84 to 92, we completed the four phases planned for Pueblo Village. We ended up with the last phase being our headquarters building. And in 93, after we had completed the main campus and the original plan, we sold our apartments and admin offices down on Mooney Road, and we kicked off a campaign to develop this 42 acres, which we were buying from the Air Force. In 93 also, we got a young, good-looking Jim Binnicker and put him on the board. I don't know what's happened there, but...
it's a residence.
So the campaign got really hot in 93. Kicked off with our first show and went from there. A lot of planning, a lot of going on. In 99, we finally signed a quitclaim to get another 4 acres and complete this beautiful 46-acre tract behind me. And that's where the new development's all going on. During these wonderful years, the local AFA chapter sponsored 11 Bob Hope shows. And these were fantastic for our community and for our foundation. I could write a history book about those shows. We had more fun with those suckers. Bob Hope brought great laughter and a lot of fun for our whole community and great fun for our widows here. He was a wonderful, generous individual. His wife, Dolores, was very generous. They spent a lot of time here with our residents and gave us so much. We had 11 of those shows. What I remember the most about him is I got to escort 5 Miss Americas. Sorry, honey, it was part of the job. We only grossed about 400,000 net out of those shows, but we got millions of dollars worth of marketing opportunities, and we exploited those. We ended up here, after we got done with the first 4 phases, of about $30 million of pre-depreciation assets. Not a tax dollar in the campus. Everything was donations from wonderful people and organizations. Helen and I became personally involved in the foundation in 77 when they asked us to build a barbecue pit over in Teresa Village. Helen and my kids, we went and got some bricks that were torn out of the old courthouse at Marianna, Florida. We cleaned them and built a barbecue area over Teresa Village. We did a lot of hogs and chicken on those barbecue pits over the years then. Helen and the kids have been deeply involved in this entire complex. We have had a lot of fun with just being part of this mess. We got caught up in the vision and the passion of one Nick Mason. This was probably the toughest little, most far-sighted individual, hardest working individual I've ever known. Everybody that got near Nick just got caught up by him. He grabbed him and made him go to work for him. Ourselves and many, many hundreds of volunteers then worked for Nick and the foundation and helped put this all together with a very small staff, mostly volunteer efforts. Nick stands today down in front of his D.N. Mason administration building. He's still looking over his cherished widows. He was all about the widows. I faded into retirement around 2000, leaving the foundation in the very capable hands of the still young and fairly good-looking Jim Binnicker. Chief Binnicker has went running with it and done great things since. Since I left the foundation, the Bob Gaetz Memorial Building and the Hawthorne House has been built to start the development of our 46 acres. And the planning has gone on with coming up with what we're here for today, the groundbreaking of Village 5. This Village 5 will be a wonderful start to get to our final goal of having the best retirement facility, which is upscale residential, has a little mix of independent, assisted, nursing, to get to be life care retirement facility and one of the finest in the land. This will happen with the development of this 46 acres, and Village 5 kicks that off. Thank you very much for having Helen and I here today. I want you to see Helen. Helen and my family are as much a part of building this place. They served, I don't know how many Thanksgiving and Christmas dinners, plucked weeds, been all over the place. My kids were so glad when I got away from this job. But I'm looking forward now to shoveling some dirt, getting to that reception. I'm hoping Don Gaetz brought some of that medical marijuana.
I think that's still illegal in a lot of places, but it's a volunteer organization, I got it. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our very special guest for today, the President of the Florida State Senate, Senator Don Gaetz, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Thanks for the opportunity to be here. I didn't bring that stuff. That's the younger, taller, smarter, better-looking Gaetz who's working on that issue. What a great day. This is like a Chamber of Commerce day. It's a perfect day, perfect temperature, not a cloud in the sky. I have to tell you, though, that in Tallahassee in the last few days, it has been cold, it's been windy, it's been miserable. It was so cold, I actually saw a politician with his hands in his own pockets. I first learned about the Air Force Enlisted Village, about Bob Hope Village, about everything you're doing here, when my neighbor knocked on my door. Duffy Ringstead. Duffy and Gene lived down the street from Vicky and me and our kids. And one day he knocked on the door and he said, I need some money. And I said, what do you need money for, Duff? He said, I need money for hole sponsorships for a golf tournament. I said, a golf tournament for what? He said, the Air Force Enlisted Village, you know, the Bob Hope Village. And I said, well, all right, you know, I wrote him a check. And then the next year, Duffy's knocking on the door. And he wants more money, so I gave him more money. And then the third year, he knocked on the door. I didn't even have to ask. I knew why he was there. He wanted money, more money for hole sponsorships. But finally, I said, Duff, I said, why are you doing this? You don't live out there. Why are you involved in this effort? And he looked at me, and he said, we take care of our own. Now, first of all, I was scared of him because he's bigger than me. But secondly, he reflected a value and a virtue that's a little bit too rare in this country and in this state, and sometimes even in this community. We take care of our own. Now, as President of the Senate, I work in a world where there are a lot of people who come and see me with their hand out. They want something for themselves, not for somebody else. They want somebody else to take care of them. But Duffy said, we take care of our own. Imagine what you're doing here. Imagine how great this is. Imagine what's already been done. People from all over this country, not just from Northwest Florida, not just from Okaloosa County, but from all over this country, have come here to find a home, to find care, to find people who care for them and care about them. You are an extraordinary institution. You are an extraordinary group of people because you have an extraordinary heart. You take care of your own. You really do. Now, what we'll break ground for today is a $17 million addition to the Air Force Enlisted Village. $17 million addition. And everything you see here, as Mr. Weaver said, has been built without a single dollar of state, federal, or local government money. It's been self-sufficient, good stewardship, good management, and great philanthropy. I think you ought to congratulate yourselves for that. And the fact that people have been able to come here and never be turned away, enlisted widows never turned away, because of an inability to pay. And that's because there are a lot of people like Duffy, a lot of people like you, who've sold a lot of hole sponsorships and a lot of other things, and I guess a lot of barbecues, Mr. Weaver, to make sure that that there would always be a place, there would always be a home, there would always be care. And as you go forward now, and you look at this extraordinary expansion of the Air Force Enlisted Village, it gets back to what Duffy said to me 23 years ago when he first knocked on my door. You are a model for this state, and I believe that you are a model for America in taking care of your own. Congratulations.
Thank you, Senator. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce the President, CEO, former Chief Master Sergeant in the Air Force, and more importantly, my boss, Chief Master Sergeant in the Air Force, Jim Binnicker.
Duffy, you need to go knock on his door again. And again. Senator Gaetz, distinguished guests, Mrs. Mary Gilmore was supposed to be here, but she's not feeling well today. But if she had been here, I would recognize her as being the oldest resident, both in age and tenure. She moved into Teresa Village in 1976. That's why it's important. You see, what we do is not a one-time deal, but it's forever. And she will be 101 in about 2 weeks. But she couldn't make it today. Sends her regards and best wishes. Also like to recognize Mike Call, the architect. Lord and son, Spike, you don't recognize him with a tie on. Coastal Bank, I'm not sure where. There she is. Thank you. Did you bring a briefcase full of money? Good. Of course, you've met Loyal Weaver, and there's another special friend in the audience, Mr. Dick Young. Dick, stand up.
Woohoo!
Dick was the deputy CEO for years, and before that, he was marketing and field operations and a bottle washer and cooker of chicken and barbecue and a little bit of everything, but he retired a couple of years ago, and we miss you. You can come back anytime. Today, this is official, but we have been working on this project for about a year. First became, the first thing that we had to do was to sell Teresa Village, and that was not an easy thing to do. A young man named Scott Meyer came to my office and said, I want to buy it, and I said, how did you know it's for sale? And he said, well, I heard about it in Sunday school. I said, well, I got to send my marketing folks to church now. I told him, I said, we will be able to agree on the price, but the thing I want to do is I want to lease it back from you for 2 years, and that'll be difficult. And it was. It was back and forth, back and forth. And finally, I got frustrated with him and told him, I said, I'm not going to sell it to you. I'll send you a Christmas card, but I'm not going to sell it to you because it's just, you don't have the interest of the residents. And he got scared and called Nick and said, hey, can you get me an extension? And we gave him an extension and we came up with the agreement. But we have been busy since the agreement with Scott, getting permits, looking for turtles and woodpecker trees. You'll be happy to know we have no turtles and no woodpecker trees in the way. Soil samples, stormwater. One resident said, I heard you were going to build it on a swamp and the Village 5 was going to sink into the ground. And so, Mr. Lord, make sure we don't sink into the ground. So how do we get to this point? About 2 years ago, I woke up and I asked the staff, what are we going to look like in 2020? I gave them three options. We can do nothing, which would have been the easiest thing to do. We could just hunker down, take care of what we got, keep painting it, play golf. But sometimes doing nothing is the riskiest of all, and so we didn't. We decided to build. So we came up with the 2020 perfect vision. That's an 8-year plan instead of a 10-year plan, but the little play on words, 2020 perfect vision. That has launched us into a strategic plan, and Village 5 is just the first step in that. Village 5 is being built for the future. But more importantly, it was built specifically for those people who live at Teresa Village to have a place to move should they choose to. And so I would like to ask the residents who intend to move to Village 5, those of you that paid your deposit, please stand so we can all recognize you. Thank you. Now, I tell the staff that I'm the smartest guy in the world, but I'm not really. I thought, you know, as we design this, Mike Hall is an architect, but he doesn't know anything about what we do, so I said, let's get the residents involved. Let them have a say-so in the floor plan and the amenities and countertops and cabinets. And so now I got my call and 96 architects. One lady asked me, she said, what color are the refrigerators? I said, stainless steel. She said, I don't like stainless steel. I said, I was holding out for avocado myself, but. So now we found out that you can't magnetize stainless steel, and everybody sticks everything to the refrigerator door, so we're going to white refrigerators that you can magnetize. It sounds trivial to you, but if you're moving into Village 5, it's important. We hired Brooke McLean to be our development guy. Smart chief, knows everybody in the Air Force, and everybody knows him, class act. He's responsible for raising $20 million. Piece of cake. Thank all of you for coming today. It means a lot to me personally. I know it does for the Village 5 residents-to-be. I wish you all the very best. I'm going to take Senator Gaetz in that silver Yukon and go down and beat you to the food line. And then we can talk some more down there. There's so many special people in the audience. As I look around, I see people, Hank Hinn, Mike Gaetz, our general counsel, Chad Hamilton, our auditor. Be nice to him. Mr. Levin Lord, the guy that owns the whole thing, a great relationship with building the Gaetz building and the Hawthorne House and now Village 5. Just a great, great relationship, and I appreciate what you're doing. I don't know how you got it down to $15 million, but thank you. Steve just fainted. When you got the microphone, you're the king, so. The senator heard me say that, so you got to do it. All I can say is thank you.
Okay, he mentions raising a lot of money, and that makes me think that we need to get the priest up here to say a prayer. So we'd now like to have Father Toledo come forward to say a prayer for us, bless the ground, and then we will do the thing we all came for and turn the dirt. Thank Father
you.
Toledo?
Thank you.
The work we are beginning today should enliven our faith and make us grateful. We know the familiar words of the psalm, if the Lord does not build a house, in vain do its builders labor. Whenever we look to the interest of our neighbor or the community and serve them, we are, in a sense, God's own co-workers. Let us pray for his help through this celebration, my brothers and sisters, that God will bring this construction to successful completion and that his protection will keep those who work on it safe from injury. Let us pray. All-powerful and all-merciful Father, you have created all things through your Son and have made him the unshakable foundation of your kingdom. Through the gift of your eternal wisdom, grant the undertaking we begin today for your glory and our own well-being may progress day by day to its successful completion. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Father Toledo. If we can now ask the official party to come forward, we will do the ceremonial groundbreaking ceremony.
Like a lot in Tallahassee.
charge, Chief.
Build a facility. We're going to improve the facilities that are out here in the grounds. But at the end of the day, what we're really doing is we're going to support widows. The facilities are just going to be the structures. The heart is what's going to be improved. So we're going to be looking forward to talking with people, explaining what our cause is, and letting them know why it's important that they donate and support us. Because this is such a wonderful location. And if you talk with the residents and you see the sacrifices they have made and the giving that they have given over their lives, it's really going to be a lot of fun to be able to pay that back to them and give them the kind of safe, secure life that they deserve.
Thank you. Good to see you. Stay well.